Hello and welcome. I'm Gauhar Raza and you are watching Eureka. Welcome Dr. Shah to Eureka as well as Rajya Sabha television.
Thank you.
I'm extremely thankful that you could give time to us. You've been very busy, but we'll be coming to that point later on. Do you still remember your school where there were no facilities, you had to walk a long distance and all that?
Yeah, we do. I mean, like, we had to walk several kilometers to reach our school.
And that too in hilly area?
That too in hilly area.
Which is very difficult to walk.
And I mean, like, so my father, I mean, like, he worked really very hard for us. I mean, like, he was bent that we should get best of the education. And I mean, like, at times he would also teach us at home. We did not have a college in Mander. So he worked, so many of the girls from our village, they couldn't go outside our, you know, tehsil to study. So what he did that he opened a college by himself. So he started giving free education to many of the students, because most of the students
from... And the focus was girls' education.
Girls' education mostly.
He knew that if a girl is educated, then the family is educated.
Some of my cousin sisters couldn't go out because it was very far off, say 70-80, and there was a taboo that you cannot send girls outside your village and all that. And they couldn't get their graduation. So he had seen that...
And there was a lot of violence around. The politics was such that it was completely violent. Yeah. Therefore, it was difficult for girls to go out.
Yeah, he had seen that in his family, so that's why. So he wanted us to, you know, study, educate. So his contribution is immense.
What about mother?
Mother, I mean, like, she definitely helped us with our basic schooling, I mean, like, teaching us and all that. She was dedicated to us. I mean, she didn't do anything in her. She was a housewife, basically. And I mean, like, all her focus was to teach us. I mean, like, she would be very happy that my son, my daughter, they get educated, they get the best of the education, they should be placed at some nice place.
She took
place.
All the burden of the household and never interfered with your education.
Yeah, yeah. So that we get educated.
And you were never asked to bring all kinds of things that are required in that hard life.
Not really. I mean, like...
You were protected.
Sometimes we had to go, I mean, like, to fetch water and all that, because we didn't have, I mean, like... You don't have the water pipelines running to your house and it's running water. So sometimes we had
to... What about electricity? How did you study in the evenings?
Sometimes electricity wouldn't come for days together. So, I mean, like, at times we would have... we could study in the candlelight. But most of the times what we used to do that, since we had to adapt, we would get up early in the morning.
What about your college education? So, because there was no college at that time. It was your father's effort which later on...
Yeah.
Resulted into a college in this.
So the nearest college to our village was around 70 kilometers away from our house. So we had an option to go to the district headquarters, Poonch, for college studies, or we had to go to Jammu. So my father chose me to send to Jammu because it was the state capital. So it was around 210 kilometers away from my village. So I did my college from...
Was there a hostel there?
No, I had to rent a room.
Room and live there
and I mean, like,
get education,
college education.
Why did you choose chemistry?
Chemistry, I was always fascinated with chemistry. Initially, when I filled up for the form for my colleges, so I was more interested in functional English and geography. Mm-hmm. So my father came to know that he has filled up the form for functional English and geography. Another choice I had put the chemistry. So he told me, no, you have to take chemistry and all that. So then again, I went to chemistry. But I liked chemistry always, so I was more into, I mean, like, I
thought... So your father knew that you like chemistry and you can do very well in chemistry.
Maybe, I mean, like...
Later on.
The reason I'm a chemist today is because of my father.
When you grew up, Kashmir was burning. Did it disrupt your education?
Not really, I mean, like, because... to some extent, yes, because then we would be, like, you know, bound inside our
houses. It made it difficult, but not disrupt.
Definitely. But did not really disturb our education, because turmoil was more, you can say, grave in Kashmir part of the area. So ours is a bordered village. So there were, like, you can say, the activity, the terrorism activity, but that was more like a passage point. So we didn't really see the worst of the terrorism. So, but still, it was, I mean, like, we had to stay in our houses after 5 or 6.
So you couldn't get out of the house after five or six?
No, not at all.
It was dark, you just couldn't.
We couldn't.
And what about disruption in the school and college?
Sometimes, yes, because I still remember an incident when we were in school, we were reading, and there was firing right next to our school. I mean, like, maybe around 1 kilometer away from our school. So, I mean, like, we would just...
You were scared?
Yeah, we were scared. As a child? We hid under the benches.
I have to take a break. Don't go anywhere. We'll come back soon. Welcome back, Dr. Shah. When did you decide that you will be doing PhD and will become a researcher?
Soon after my MSc, I have thought of doing my PhD even in my university days. I mean, like, when I was doing my MSc, I thought of doing a PhD after my this MSc, because I was not interested in civil services. I didn't go for medicine and all that. So I was
not management.
No, not management. So I was always interested in doing PhD. So I went to Dr. Taneja, my PhD supervisor in Indian Institute of Integrative Medicine. And there I was exposed to, I mean, like, very high quality science, high quality research. And I was like, okay, now this breaks you away from the mundane routine every day. I mean, like, every day you go into the lab, you have something new to do. I mean, like, so that really excites me still. I mean, you work with the brightest of the people.
There is physical chemistry, there is biochemistry. You joined this stream because it was a fashion to join biochemistry, or you were interested in biochemistry and that's it?
So actually, I am an organic chemist, basically.
Yeah.
So basically, I was more fascinated by the drugs, medicines, I mean, like, their development, their average, I mean, like, every single, you can say, every single step is different, I mean, like, and you learn a lot from these things. So that was the reason precisely I took organic chemistry. So I was interested in drug development.
That was your basic question, that how drugs are developed and how can you help the country develop drugs or society develop drugs.
Absolutely.
Have you been able to develop a drug?
I haven't been, but like, I'm working towards
not
that.
Yet.
Not yet. I mean, like, it's a very long process. I'm too young.
The process of extraction of various compounds and elements from bioresources is a very long drawn process. It's not simple. You have columns, extraction, everything. But it has been also very fast changing field.
Yes.
The extraction process itself, because it's very expensive in terms of time as well as in terms of money. So how have you overcome this problem? Are you in sync with the international standards?
Yeah, we are. I mean, like, our facilities are, you can say, at par with any of the international labs we have. So
CSIR gave you the chance to develop your lab, and these facilities are the best. Would you like to talk about these facilities? How did you create it?
Let me start with that microbial natural product, because I am currently working on natural product chemistry. A part of my work is on natural product chemistry. So we are working on microbial natural products. So Jammu and Kashmir, you know, it has it is uniquely placed. So you have cold deserts of Ladakh, you have tropical and temperate.
Let me try to understand. Microbial chemistry at this level would mean that you are looking for elements and compounds in microbes which can be used for developing drugs. Is that right?
Yes.
Yeah, please go ahead.
So the first ever drug we all know is penicillin. The advent of penicillin started this area of developing microbial natural products, or you can say natural products from microbes. So the problem with microbes is that, we have only exploited less than 1% of the, you can say, the microorganisms that exist in the world. Because
we have not mapped all of them.
Yeah, mapped all of them. And the biggest problem is they are uncultivable. But now we have techniques, we can, you know, express them in a different microorganisms. And I mean, like, there are technologies coming up through which we can culture these microorganisms. And I mean, like, they can be a source of, you know, novel bioactive molecules. The biggest contribution of microorganisms is basically in the field of antibiotics. And I mean, like, of all the natural products, around 40%
which
are from...
Which revolutionized the drugs and our understanding of diseases.
Yeah, yeah. I mean, like, since antibiotic resistance is coming, I mean, like, we are living in basically post-antibiotic era right now. So, it becomes even more important to look for the newer molecules, I mean, newer scaffolds which can overcome the resistance these molecules are offering. So,
There are two things that I would like to ask you. One, that science is probably no more an individual endeavor, and therefore your papers have large number of
authors,
colleagues and friends.
Yeah. Yes.
It goes up to 13,
yeah,
as I counted in one of your papers.
Yeah.
And the other is that without basic sciences, without basically understanding the nature and how it operates, can you develop drugs or any product for that matter in today's world?
No, I mean, like, not at all, I mean, I would say. Because you see, I mean, like, we have to, you know, basically, you know, understand nature, and I mean, like, we have to explore our natural resources systematically. I mean, like, we have so much rich biodiversity throughout India. I mean, like, all over India, we can, you know, we can, if we can, you know, our institute, for example, has an astounding microbial repository of 300 microbial strain. I mean, 3,000, sorry, 3,000 microbial strain. And I mean, like, if we do systematic exploration, we grow them under different conditions, because many of the biosynthetic gene clusters, the microbes, they don't express at all. But now we have techniques, I mean, like, we can perturb those, you know, biosynthetic pathways, and we can produce novel molecules out of this microbial strain. So, I mean, like, now it's, you know, the interest in natural products, rather you can say, has never been greater than it is now. Right now it's like, it's booming like anything, I mean, you can say.
In other words, what you are saying is that India is a beautiful country, which is also a melting pot of biodiversity.
Indeed.
And indeed, it is unique in that sense. And we have not been able to explore all of it.
Yes.
Where indeed our focus should be.
Yes, indeed.
And we need to also probably give a lot of, spend a lot of money to do that.
Yeah.
Should India as a poor country do that?
Yeah, definitely. I mean, like, if we can develop, see, I mean, like, companies are not gonna, you know, put their money in diseases which are neglected, and we have so many diseases in India which are neglected. I mean, like, we being a public sector, you know, organization, we have to do that. We'll have to take up those things. So usually what happens, scientists are usually, you know, cut off from this social thread. I mean, like, you can say,
as a young scientist, would you argue that CSIR is the best place to do it, and you will be able to do it?
Definitely.
Just to take a small break, don't go anywhere, we'll come back soon. Welcome back. Dr. Shah, we were discussing that you have full confidence that CSIR can do it. What gives you this confidence? There has been a cut on spending on science and technology. A lot of young researchers like you have been very disturbed about these bright students leaving.
Yes.
Because there are no scholarships there. Yes. So what gives you the confidence that CSIR or in India, we'll be able to do it if such cuts continue?
Seeing the whole, I mean, like, the scenario, you, as you said, I'm like, definitely funding is a problem right now. We have fund cuts and all that. But still, I mean, like, I think CSIR offers probably the best setup to, you know, do this kind of work. It's one of the best public sector setup where you can do this kind of work. And CSIR-IIIM Jammu, Indian Institute of Integrative Medicine Jammu, I must say, is doing the cutting edge research in the area of drug development. Particularly, we have programs going for the drug development in the area of anti-infectives, anti-cancer, immunosuppressants,
malaria.
And, like, yeah, and I mean, like, we are taking up
many other programs.
And we have, the best part is that we have in-house facility of, you can say, biologists, chemists, you can say microbiologists, and it's a unique, you can say, setup under one roof. I mean, like, and I
mixture of multi
yes, absolutely,
science and breaking the boundaries, coming together, yeah, trying to crack problems. What is that big question that you want to crack?
So I mean, like, with respect to research, can we develop new molecules which can, I mean, like, because so that we can give it to the, I mean, like, which are accessible to the poorest of Indians. I mean, like, cheaper drugs, better life quality, I mean, like, better health. And I mean, like, if we can, you know, take science to the schools, so that will be great for our country as a whole.
Are you a science communicator? Do you go to schools and give lectures in college to give lectures?
I used to. I mean, like, after my PhD, I did. I mean, like, I used to make it a
time. Now you don't get time?
Now I don't get time, but now I think I'll again start doing that. I mean, like, because that is the thing I love. I mean, like, you, when you reach out to the younger students, I mean, like, it's sometimes it's really very heartening, you can say that.
It's amazing to find a young scientist who is almost producing one paper a month. And the graph of your publications is very, very steep. When you started in 2008, then you published maybe 2-3 papers.
Yes.
In these 2 months, you have produced 4 papers.
Yes.
Last year, you produced around 12 papers. How could you manage that at this young age? I know of older scientists who will have that kind of average, but at this young age, how could you do this?
As I said earlier, I mean, like, the best part of this profession is that you get to work with the best of the students, the brightest of the students. I mean, so I mean, like, definitely they help us. They are very hardworking people. We could not publish anything without their help. I mean, they are the one who actually work in the lab. We are writing those papers and we are communicating those things, but they are the one actually who are, you know, doing the work in the lab. I mean, like, I would give it to my students. I mean, like, they are really very hardworking. Sometimes they would stay till 12 in the night. I mean, like, they are working very, very hard to, you know, with whatever resources they have. I mean, like, they tend to complete those projects. That's why precisely I think that, you know, we have a very high chance of getting something big from our CSIR labs.
So in this bad time, bad economic times, you remember somebody like C.V. Raman, who worked in very bad conditions but produced world-class research?
Yeah.
And Indians have done very well when they are under pressure.
I think Indians are best at adapting to their conditions, to their resources. I think they can get the best out of anything, Indians.
So CSIR and your lab and your group is going to do better and better.
Better.
Maybe the frequency of publications will increase. 6 patents at this young age.
Yes.
3 chapters in a book. Oh. And 64 papers. It's amazing. Do you have this confidence that if we produce better and better scientific manpower within the country, then we'll be able to sustain that manpower through the institutions that exist?
Yeah. So actually the idea is to retain that manpower. We are producing the best of the students, I mean, like, the brightest of the PhD students, scholars here, but we are not able to retain those people in our country. I mean, like, after doing their PhD, they look for the better avenues, they go for the postdoctoral fellowship.
And they do much better outside.
Outside, because they have better resources, you can say that. I mean, like, so we have to find a mechanism, I mean, like, so that we can retain the best of the people. Not only retain best of the people, that so that we can attract best of the minds from outside as well. So, I mean, like, if that happens, our basic science will grow, so will our productivity, and so will our application. I mean, like, our country will, as a whole, will grow.
You have been to US.
Yes.
Not for very long time. How do you look at the two cultures, science being done here and science being done in United States of America?
I must say, I mean, like, the quality of work we are doing here is, you can say, at par with the work that
being done. But what about work culture?
But the work culture, I think certain things we have to, their professionalism and all that, we have to inculcate that in our society as well. I mean, like, the way they approach the problem, I mean, it's commendable.
So would you suggest that your students should go and look at the work culture there, come back and inculcate and
inculcate
those values?
Definitely. I mean, like,
will that help?
Yeah, definitely that will help.
You're asking for a lot of money by saying that.
Yeah, I mean, but it will be good for, I mean, like, because it will be good for those students as well. I mean, like, they'll be exposed to high quality research, how the problems are being tackled and many other things. I mean,
you got this Young Scientist Award last year.
Yes.
And this is the best award that India offers to any young scientist in the country. How excited were you?
I was very excited.
Did you dance?
No, not really.
Did you cut cake?
No, not really. I mean, but I was really very excited. I mean, like, it's a recognition for your work. And I mean, like, it's very heartening. You realize that something, you are doing something good. You are going in right direction and somebody is, you know, putting a stamp on that. I mean, like, okay, your work is good and you are going in the right direction.
What about your family, parents?
My father and my mother, they were really very excited.
Do you think in India for young people, especially scientists, there should be more awards?
Definitely, yes. But more than awards, I would be very happy if, you know, the funding is more liberal to young scientists because they tend to do so many things. So, you know, being in the 30s and 40s, you have the, you know, best of the energy and all that. You want to do so many things. But sometimes, you know, funding inhibits you from doing many a things. I mean, like, I would be very happy if, you know, the funding is more generous to the young people at least. You should promote young people, I mean, like, to do science and all that.
Would you like to give a message to the younger ones? You yourself is so young.
So, I mean, like, I would quote Pablo Picasso here that every child is born as an artist. The idea is to stay the same as an adult. So I would say every child is born as a scientist. So the idea is to stay the same as an adult. So I would ask the younger generation to do not stop questioning. I mean, like, keep observing and I mean, like, come into the science. It's very, very interesting. And I mean, like, you can do so much for your country.
Don't stop questioning. Keep it up and you will be the scientist that Dr. Shah is. May I, on your behalf, promise our viewers that you will be happy to answer questions
sure.
in your area or any
sure, sure.
any question or
sure,
comment
sure.
they have.
Sure.
Please do write to us if you have any comment or question. Our email address is eurekarstv@gmail.com. We'll come back next week with another outstanding scientist of the country. Till then, goodbye.